Hello everybody, this is Fernando for the latest Mysteries and Oddities video. Alright, let's go ahead and let's do another entry here. This one yet again based on one of your newer suggestions. This one having to do with a gentleman who was actually considered one of the tallest living people on the planet. In actuality, he was somewhere around 20th or 21 when it comes to the tallest people. But the main reason why I wanted to include him here was because when I was reading all the information tied to his life, I just found it so fascinating. I just definitely had to share everything about him here. This was because not only about him and as far as his own intricacies that made things so fascinating, but the people that he ended up meeting, the locations he went to, places that he lived. There was just so many extraordinary stuff that I wanted to share here that I thought it would be perfect to be able to focus on this series. So not necessarily something on the lines of an oddity, but more on the lines of something that I just had to share with everyone, considering I've never heard of him before, and there's a good chance others haven't out there, and that's the whole purpose of this particular series. In fact, you're looking at him now. His real name was Zhang Shi Chai, but as always, when it comes to performances, he went under a moniker, and it was known as Chang, the Chinese Giant. So let's go ahead and let's talk about all the fascinating info tied to this gentle giant, and then you'll understand why I definitely wanted to share him here. So who was Chang the Chinese Giant? Well, he was someone who still has a lot of mystery tied to his life to this day. I mention that because apparently with 5 autobiographies being depicted of him, all of them are separate from each other. So as far as where the truth lies within each one, I'm sure there is a little bit of each one having it. You just have to pick and choose. There's still a lot of mysteriousness though tied to it as well. Like for example, his date of birth is still up in the air. Like for example, he could have been born in the early 1840s or maybe even up to the late 1840s as well. So 1841 to 1847 is still up for the debate. Even his family, who he lived with when he was growing up, also remains a mystery. This is because apparently at one point his sister was taller than him, and so he may have had a family of giants, but such is the case with anyone having this form of gigantism, they just continue growing. And when that happened, even his eventual growth, which was somewhere along the lines of 8 feet tall before he died, if he had lived even longer, then he could have been even taller afterward. But still, the time period with his family, how he lived with them, who was in there, that still remains mysterious to this day too. What is known is that sometime around 1865, so this could have been around his mid-20s or so, he left China to travel to London. Somewhere along the way, a manager found him, and they were able to showcase him to the rest of the world. It started there in London, in fact, and that's when he began appearing on stage, and then he was traveling around Europe afterward. What made him so fascinating, and the reason why I wanted to share him here, was because people's expectations of him were completely just blown on the water when they met him. In fact, he was presented as someone, and truly was, an intellectual. Like, for example, he spoke up to 10 languages fluently, so he could absolutely hold any conversation with anyone out there. And in fact, when people met him, he was described as being one of the noblest and gentlest of men who have ever been seen. He was presented either as being regal, like for example, a lot of his attire you could see had a lot of Asian culture tied to it, and then in other situations, he was presented in more Western, gentlemanly clothing, and in other situations, he was even presented with having a military uniform. So it all, I guess, depended on the type of clientele that he was meeting with, but either way, though, he was definitely having a good amount of success. He was also someone who was considered a ladies' man. So many women, in fact, became interested in him because he was also very, very handsome. Apparently, people that met this Chang, the Chinese giant, considered him to have a very effeminate quality, a very mild, very gentle, but still very striking when it came to his looks. Women would actually come up to him and give him presents, and I think the way I was reading it, it was asked to go out with him or other stuff going forward with that, and still he wanted to showcase that he was a gentleman and he didn't pursue any of those things. But it just goes to show again how, if he, and when it came to partners, he definitely didn't have any lacking possibilities. In fact, this could have been because of this. There was a woman who was seen frequently within many of his pictures. We don't know, though, like the mystery of that woman, like in terms of her relation to him. She could have been his wife, or she could have been a performer, someone that was just there as part of the act of him being shown throughout tours and multiple parts of the area. So as far as, again, having a relationship with her or not, we don't know. But still, later on down the line, he did meet someone that I'll talk about here in a minute. And it goes to show, again, how much of a ladies' man he was. But eventually, he moved over to America, and he became part of P.T. Barnum's Greatest Show on Earth. And then that's when things truly hit off. Like, at that point, he was touring throughout multiple parts of America, gaining a good amount of money. In fact, he was earning around $500 a month during this time period. So somewhere around that time, maybe around 1860s to 1870s, I tried to find a calculator for it, like an inflation calculator, just to try to showcase how much that would be. But the problem is, the inflation calculators only go back to about 1912, 1913. So rough guess, rough estimate was, on a yearly basis, he was making about $250,000 doing these particular tours. Not bad, again, for someone that was just doing his thing and still making a lucrative living out of it. And then eventually he decided, but the way his manager and then the way the tours went, he met a good amount of people that would be considered very, very affluent. In fact, people state that at one point he could have met the Prince of Wales, the Duke of Cambridge, and then also the Queen herself. Not only that, but also meeting a Prime Minister, several sultans, and then several emperors as well, including the Emperor of Germany and then the Emperor of Austria. And not only that, but also the Emperor of China as well, which is a very, very big deal, considering when I was reading some of the history associated with emperors of China, how rare that is to be able to meet them. But just goes to show, again, with this man, with this Chang, the Chinese giant, here was someone that you could just assume would just be like an oddity, like nobody would want to do anything with him. But everyone that met him, again, described what a gentle nature he had, how much of a good friend he was, and everyone just totally wanted to be able to be friends with him. But the oddity, or the strange thing about it, was as big as he was, no pun intended, when it came to his performance, he was actually a very private person. He absolutely just wanted to have a private life. In fact, in one of his last quotes before he died, he had stated that, "I have never cared to be shown." And this was someone that, again, you could just tell that he was acting, almost like an actor would. How you read about certain actors where they're really, really big in Hollywood, they're really big in that kind of showbiz life, but in their private world, they absolutely just don't want anything to do with people. Not because necessarily that they're against people, but they just want to have a private life. Such was the case here with Chang, the gentle giant. So in his case, when he finally made enough money, in fact, after about maybe 20 or 25 years of touring, he had enough money to retire. Not bad, again, for someone that was just doing these type of performances. He ended up retiring at a place called Bournemouth, which is an area, a home that you're kind of looking at now. The reason I say kind of is because when he lived there, it was his own personal home. He apparently went there because he was suffering from a disease which is apparently tied to tuberculosis. And maybe he went there to be able to relax, to try to be healthy, to try to use the surrounding locations to revitalize his health. By that point, though, he was married to an Australian. In fact, her name was Catherine Santley, and she ended up having two kids with him, and they were born there within that area as well. But there's a lot of mystery, again, tied to these children and what happened to them afterward. But he retired to that location. He ended up setting up a shop involving a, like, kind of like a little mini store. I guess it was tied to his home. And then he was able to sell Chinese imports and then also create a Chinese tea house. But today, that particular location, it took a little bit of a hunt, but I found it. You're looking again at it now. This is actually now known as the Ashley Hotel. And if you go there to this very day, you can kind of see some of the remnants of his home. At the time, because of his height, many of the hallways, many of the ceilings, and including the front entrance were made 10 feet tall. This was, of course, to accommodate him, as he would easily move about. But later on, once he died and then the place was converted over to a hotel, then it was changed in terms of those levels. But you can still at least find his particular picture, like, in other words, a newspaper and a picture there dedicated to him. And then somewhere around that area near a cemetery, that's where he's buried. In fact, he ended up passing away around 1893, November 5th, 1893, to be specific. And that was around age 50 or so. It's approximate again because of the notoriety associated with his date of birth. But when he ended up passing away, the mysterious knights tied to him even was there to the very last day. He stated somewhere along the lines that when he passed away, he didn't want anybody to know where he was buried. And so if you go there to the cemetery to try to find his particular location, you may find it, but you're not going to find any grave. Like, there's no grave at all. There's no indication that he's buried there specifically. It's just his way, in other words, of once again having a very, very private life. So when it comes to this guy, Chang the Chinese Giant, or again his real name known as Zhan Shikai, very, very fascinating life, from being born in a set of mysterious circumstances to traveling the world to making a good amount of money to meeting a lot of dignitaries out there, being a ladies' man. So this is someone, again, that ended up just having just a very, very private sentimentality, a very private life, and then ended up passing away in that location. In fact, if you were there towards his later years, the way it was said about him was he always wanted to go out at night. He wanted to still have his privacy. He didn't necessarily want people to disturb him. So much so, in fact, that before he died, he had 10-foot walls built around his home to maintain that privacy. But those that he was able to befriend and those that he met just around the town would again always say how warm and gentle he was. But there he was. They always saw him late at night walking around through his own thoughts. And then he would use, get this, he would use the gas lights that were there high up on the poles wherever they were throughout the town. He would use those particular gas lights to light his cigar. And that's one of the main memories that I got when I was reading all his information here. But what do you guys think about this gentle giant, Chang the Chinese Giant in this case, Mr. Zhang Shichai? If anyone has any more information, anything else about him missed about him, please post those comments below. Anybody go down there to that location there in Bournemouth? If anybody has gone there specifically to that hotel as well, well, you're in luck. You actually were in the residence of Chang himself. You were actually within his home when he was living there. And how fascinating would that be to be able to be at that location and realize that specifically? If I'm ever about, for whatever reason, by that area, I would make the trip. I would go down there just to be able to experience how he lived during that particular time. And who knows, I might go back to that nearby cemetery to try to see if I could find that particular plot. But in any case, again, if anyone has any more information, anything else might have missed, please post those comments below. All right, everybody. Thanks again, as always. Take care.